My bad. What's up?
You are not going to be the first one to try to figure out how Instagram works on the day of the show.
Exactly.
But welcome, welcome, Ndey, Fatou, Ceesay.
Hey.
Should I reintroduce myself?
Yes, please.
So my name is Danny Constant, and I will be having a gist with you this afternoon, or this evening, or this night, wherever, depending on the time frame or time zone you are in. Because I don't know how you do this. We think you're in Asia. We think you're in America. We think you're in Gambia. It's fascinating how you just confuse us. It's good. You're doing good with your enemies, though. You just, I'm around the world type of people.
I just be sliding, you know, one day here, next day there, you know, switch it up.
Yeah. you're doing great, but welcome to Crude. I hope you certainly will have fun with us right here, on this platform. Let me get started by saying, what has 2020 been for you? What has this year been like for you?
To be honest, this year, I know a lot of people wouldn't feel the same, but for me, this year has been amazing, completely, because okay. I took some big risks in coming back home, mm-hmm. and when I got here, I was actually planning to go again, and then Corona hit, and honestly, it's been the best thing that's ever happened to me, in without like being disrespectful to other people and how this year has been for them. Mm-hmm. I definitely, it's been quiet, so okay. I was really able to like be in my own little art cave and, you know, just try and boss up on the things that I really and truly believe in. And also I realized the people that I really, really love, because I really miss them during this time, and the people mm-hmm. that, you know, like, peace out, but, you know, we're still cool, but, you know, mm-hmm. it is what it is, but it definitely made me realize a lot of things about who I am and the people I like to be around and what I like to do. So for me, it's been an eye-opening year. That's what I can say. Yeah.
Okay. Being an eye-opening year, like I told you, if you don't know now, you should know. So there's a little bio of her right there on the screen. So if you cannot read. We're trying to help you read for those people that are a little old and their sight is fading at this point. So NFC is pretty much her brand name as well. If you can see on her DP, what do they call the DP or display display picture? she has those initials over there. So she's creative with background and interest in fashion, apparel, footwear, concept creation, and product designing. Well, her background is a creative. She's basically been the creator, creative director of Noir, like Fashion Week London, opened in 2015, Global Entrepreneur Summit, delegate in 2015. She's been a Nike diversity design apprentice in 2018, Nike footwear design intern in 2019, creative director of the NFC 2020 Fashion Accelerator Program Consultant SIG 2020. That is quite an achievement. Let me just certainly put it out right there. So my question is, what does it take to be unapologetically yourself, right, in a conservative society like Gambia in 2020?
Well, Danny, that's a great question. It's actually very hard. You know, you have to keep pushing yourself forward, and you have to just believe that you are who you are, you know. You can't really try and be someone else, because then you won't be authentic. And what people are really looking for is that authenticness, you know. They want to feel connected to you in some way, and you are also trying to be connected to them. So if you come in with something that's not really you, it doesn't really work out that well, you know. Like Gambia is quite a conservative culture, I would say.
Yeah.
And being a woman in a conservative culture is like even more like of a mind thing. But yeah. I would say that, you know, I do have a really strong support system. You know, I have people that you know, they always like, no matter what design, you know, category or line I tried to go in, they're like, okay, cool, we're doing this now, all right, let's do it then, you know. Yeah. So that really helps me to just kind of keep going with the flow. And like, also I'm a bit of a, like a, I don't know, an aloof type of human being, where if I feel like this is what I want to do, I just kind of be like, okay, fine, I'm gonna go and do that. So you know, it's very good to care about people's feelings, and at the same time it's good to make sure that you're taking care of yourself, you know.
Yeah. Okay. You're a success story. I would, even if you wouldn't want to gravitate to that, I'm just gonna say I'm speaking that into existence already. Regardless how you feel about it, but how does it feel to be you? You know, with all the knowledge of creativity that you have, that you currently possess, because you have knowledge. I mean, you've been able to travel, so there's so much that you have learned over this year, over the period of this year. Now, so how that creativity, how does it feel being you?
Honestly, I'm just grateful. I'm so grateful to all the opportunities that I've had, all the chances that I've had to actually be in the vicinity of people who are way more creative than me and learn from them and like really put in effort to be better. So, you know, I just, right now, 2020, I feel good. I feel good. That's what I can say. I feel good. I'm doing my thing. I'm minding my business. I feel good. Yeah. Yeah.
Why haven't you given up on Gambia? It's a very tough place. Let me just say, I saw a tweet this morning, and this gentleman was talking about how, I mean, he's Gambian. He loves Gambia, and he's always thinking about, you know, going back home and looking at what's happening in the country. It discourages him from venturing into that. And he's like, man, let's just leave that. Let's just stay in whatever part of the world we are in, and just watch from far. Now, why haven't you given up on Gambia?
Danny, you know what? I actually do not know. Like, something just keeps bringing me back here every time. You've seen me when I'm like, I'm gone. I'm never coming back. Literally. It's like, yeah. Danny, you're on the other side. Yeah. Yeah, a few times I've done that. But I don't know. Something keeps bringing me back here. And honestly, it's a great place to be, like, kind of like an artist. It really is, because you get to, you know, it's living is not necessarily cheap, but it's not so expensive that you can't do a couple of jobs here and there and get by, you know. So for someone like me that wants to do different things, I may have to have a 9-to-5 if I was somewhere else. But here, you know, I can just bop over to my parents' yard, be like, you know what, can I just grab a couple of pieces of rice or something? Like, can I just, you know? So that also helps me out. And, you know, Gambia is home at the end of the day. And even though there's a lot of annoying things here, a lot, okay? There's also some, you know, wonderful... There's a feeling in Gambia that I don't think exists anywhere else. It almost feels like you land here and then it's just like... You know, everything just slows down. And then you can really think and hear and, you know. So that's one thing I do like about Gambia. I won't say I'll be here forever, because I could just get one of my episodes where I'm just like, I'm out. But for now, I'm here. Yeah.
Okay. You mentioned family. And you come from a very rich family in terms of achievements, you know. Your regardless of the fact that many people don't really know the connections here. I mean, you have amazing brothers, you have successful brothers, yourself. I mean, how's the family dynamic now? Like, has there ever been clash? I mean, your brother's a Hollywood superstar actor. Your other brother is actually just becoming a real man himself, making a name for himself. You on the other hand is, I mean, you're paving your path through, you know, fashion and creativity. Has there ever been a moment where you feel like maybe there's like a clash of, in the family, so, you know, as when it comes to the attention or, you know, who's leading the charts of achievement?
Well, actually, it's funny you ask that, but we don't actually have that, luckily. Like,
okay.
Who's my biggest fan, and Tijan, yes, is my biggest fan. So both of them love me the most, and I love both of them the most. So it kind of works out in a good way where, you know, Babu is very inspiring to me. He's one of the people who pushed me when I was doubting my abilities. And yeah, he's always been, like, very supportive of many things that I've wanted to do. So for me, I'm really grateful for that. You know, like, we do have our little, you know, our things where I'm like, well, you know that I'm
no, best. Okay. So, well, example, I mean, well, to have a superstar actor like Babu Ceesay as brother, what do you guys even argue about? Like, does he ever get in character before he has to? I'm gonna choose to be, you know, like the mean villain. Yeah.
Well, it just depends, you know. He takes his job extremely seriously, so right, like, if he's practicing for a role, yeah, he'll go into that type of, you know, vicinity where he becomes that human being. But okay, I'm just as extra as him, so, you know, it would just be, okay, me too, I'm about to start doing some artistic thing over here, and you do you, and I'll do me, and
yeah.
So definitely it's a good eclectic kind of surrounding for creatives and people that like to do things that are in the entertainment side of stuff. Like, it's good to bounce off each other, definitely.
Now, have you ever boasted about your brother out there?
Oh hell yeah!
Now, someone says things like that. Do you know who my brother is? Like, do you know?
No, I always save it. I always save it for the bum last guy at it. It's like, I'm always like, okay, you know what? No. I just see him as my brother, you know.
Okay.
I'm just joking when I say that. I see him as my brother. I love him for just who he is. I'm super proud of him. You know, when I need clout, yeah, I can throw him in there, put him on the table. But, like, half the time, I'm just glad that I have, like, wonderful brothers that love me to death, that I love to death, that are always supportive.
Okay. Let me just go back a little bit to go forward. You went to the University of Liverpool in, you know, in the UK. You have a BA in combined honors. I've been combined honors pretty much in politics and languages.
Yes.
That's huge. Let me just put it. That is huge. Los Angeles Trade Technical College, fashion designing. That's 2018-2020. Concept creation as well. Pencil. That is a lot on your resume. Guys, if you haven't Googled her, please take your time to do it. I know, listen, it's good that we do that, because we sometimes take people for granted when we just see them. And it's important that we kind of look at where they're coming from to understand where they're going or the point at which they are in right now. As a creator, what are you proud of right now?
Oh, okay. I would say that what I'm most proud of is being picked to join the apprentice team at Nike.
Okay.
I really did feel a little bit out of my depth when I was competing with everyone. And being picked, even though I was determined and I was like, I'm going to give it my best, being picked was definitely like, it was, you know, it was just, it was amazing. I remember finding out and just being like, I'm in me. And it was just a dope feeling. I was just ready and excited. And honestly, I'm so grateful for that experience, definitely.
Now, being part of Nike Diversity Apprentice Program, What was it like? I mean, you guys just walk around and they gave you Nikes and you just wear it every day, like new, like, or are you in the concept room where they design all this great different, you know, brands or styles of shoes? Yeah, like, what is it like? What was it like being part of that program?
Well, it was amazing. Like, first we had to compete against each other. We had to compete in four different categories. Mm-hmm. So there was like graphic design, footwear design, apparel, and color design. And yes. we had to compete all four of those. You had to do something for. And there was like a timeline. It was kind of like 1 hour, 15 minutes, get it, you know? And everybody just had to do what they were doing and come up with a concept. But we had already been given briefs before then, like telling us what kind of design they were looking for and what the consumer, who the consumer was going to be. Yeah. So we had to do that. And then after, out of the people that came to the combine, they picked 13, my 13. Yeah. So we all went to, I can see some of them on here. That's so sweet. You know, they shipped us off to Portland, where the Nike World headquarters is. And then when we were there, they divided us into groups. So some of us were put in graphics, some of us were put in color, some of us were put in apparel, and some in footwear. So I was put in footwear materials, and mm-hmm. I had never even heard about that. So I was a little bit worried, and I was also put in the Jordan brand and Nike Bayou brand. So yeah. I was kind of balancing them too, and I wasn't, you know, I really felt out of my depth, but they did assign us with some hardcore mentors that like would not let us slack off for a minute, and we got to learn so much from them and so much from each other. And it was you know, Nike's a huge company and there's so many people working there, but there's only about 1,020 designers in like 80,000 employees. So the design team is really small. So it's very close niche, and you know, you get to hang out at the studio, and we just spent most of our time creating, building, doing. And I think that was the first time that I was surrounded by people that were very much creative like me. Yeah. And it was nice to be around them, because you just felt like, okay, we're all weirdos. We're going to go build some stuff now. See ya. You know, so that was good. Yeah, that was good. I would say that, you know, I wouldn't change that experience for anything.
That's beautiful. Now, and you at some point, I feel like there was a time when there was the names that were bouncing off. You had Noir, especially in terms of your brand. You were trying out a lot of stuff here and there, and colors. I remember when you had a collection. You had a black collection. It was interesting just understanding what exactly was going on in your mind at that particular point. You showcased at the Fashion Week in Gambia a few years, pretty much prior at the beginning stage of the events. Do you feel like you found yourself?
Yes. I'm always scared to say that because I don't know. I might turn around and be like, guys, I'm going to go and do this now. So I'm always scared to say that, but I do feel like I did find myself, because when I was doing fashion, don't get me wrong, I do love fashion. I love apparel. I love dressing up and all those things. But I look back at the things I used to do and I realized that I was always trying to over detail everything. And that's because I was just like dying to build things. And with fashion, it's kind of like a flow. But I wanted, like, I was always doing the braiding and the embroidery and the beading. It was always like some sort of crafty, innovative stuff. And when I actually got to explore other areas of design, I realized, okay, I like to innovate. I see. This is why, you know, this is why I'm always trying to add something to something else. It's because I'm, you know, that's really and truly who I am. And there's a lot of aspects of art that I find very exciting. So for me, like now, I don't feel tied to having to make clothes for people. And I don't feel tied to having to have a brand. I'm just NFC. I'm doing what I'm doing. So today I'll be doing that. Tomorrow I might do this. But every time I'm going to try and come correct and give you guys 100.
Okay. How does your parents feel about this? I mean, you know, it's one thing for us to go to school, get an education, And the fact that they put money on it, they want to see their money's worth. Do you understand? So, and if it's if it if it's not if it's not really tangible, if it's not something they're proud of, they usually look at you like, yo, you know, I'm gonna let them feel that way. Okay, bahna, yalla bahna, you know I said that. Do you understand what I'm saying? So, but at this point, do you feel like they're proud of everything that you've achieved?
At this point, yes. At this point, okay. I really do feel like they're proud. You know, at first, I'm sure they poor souls, I'm sure they were thinking, what is wrong with our kids? Like, what are they trying to do? But, as time went by, you know, they began, Babu was the first to break out and be like, I'm going to acting school. So they already had to deal with him before I came along. And, you know, so they were already kind of getting used to the fact that we're not going to be doctors or lawyers or anything of the sort. And then by the time, by the time I came along, my mom is also quite creative in terms of, like, doing clothes. And she's also designed in the past. So, you know, I kind of used that to be like, oh, I'm going to be like you, Mom. And, you know, that kind of worked. And then when I started, like, running off doing some painting here and whatever, she was like, okay, girl, you need to focus. But, you know, and that's always been a problem of mine where I think I'm not focused. But now I realize I am focused. I'm just doing a lot of things focusedly. If that makes any sense.
Okay. Okay, I like that. You're doing so many things focused, and I feel I can relate to you as well, because sometimes I feel like there's so much you want to do, there's so much that you feel like you can achieve at one go, and not many people have the tendency of understanding that, because for most people it's if you're this, that's what you are, and that's what you need to pursue, that's what expectations are for you. And if you're trying to diversify, then you're like, yeah, Kimo Muhammad Bobam. You know, like, you don't know what you want. You seriously don't know what you want. But let me ask you this. Before we get into the How Gambian Are You segment.
Okay.
A little crazy. I'm gonna put you on the spot right there.
Woo! Nervous.
I'll put you on the spot right there.
Just know I know where you live.
Someone was asking where you are. She's in Gambia, guys. She's in Gambia. That's her workshop.
Hey, everybody.
That's her workshop right there. That's her workshop. That's where the magic happens. but let me ask, how do you choose your friends? Like, who are your friends though?
Who are my friends?
Yes.
Honey, are you trying to imply that I'm always alone or something? Okay, fine. You know what? I do have friends. Most of my friends are in London and in the States and are all around the world. But I have friends in Gambia too. Like, I have a lot of friends in Gambia. I went to...
I have a lot of friends in Gambia. Like, who are your friends? That's the question. Who are your
friends?
Soma
is my friend.
Somanya Angate is a friend.
No, Somanya, he lives here. It's not Angate.
Anyway, Angate, I borrow Angate. So, yes.
Why, yeah. Soma's my friend. Ali's my friend. Lena's my friend. All these Fashion Weekend people are my friend. Like, I'm just friendly with everybody. I might not be like close. Okay. But I spend a lot of time working and stuff, and I'm kind of a private person. Even though I'm out there, I like to keep my... Danny, you know what? You better stop it. Stop it, okay? Listen, I do have friends out here. Lots, okay? Yeah.
Okay. It's fine.
Where's my friends at? People are hitting up right now. I have lots of friends. I hang out with lots of people.
It's okay. Okay, but you just showed yourself. So I'm glad we can see who your friends are at this point. I mean, Daraja Boutique Ali has been.
Yeah, Daraja. Yeah, exactly.
What do you mean is exactly?
You know what it is, Danny? I didn't grow up here. So I didn't really get to make those close connections with people like that. And then also, like, I did go to Marina for a year and a half. During that time, you know, I met, like, some, you know, my crew, my sisters that, you know, I'm still sisters with them. They know who they are, you know, but they're not here. So what am I supposed to do, you know? You know, I grew up in Togo. I went to BSL. I had my crew there, and I'm still cool with them, too. Yeah.
Okay. So
now that... I feel like I'm Ndey Fatou, no friends.
It's okay. It's okay. We understand. We understand. We overstand.
Overstand.
That way. How Gambian are you? This is a segment where we get to test the things.
Wow. How Gambian are you? Shit. Yeah. Oh wow. Okay. Give me.
Okay. Are you ready? This is where the comment section are meant to help you. But since you don't have friends, that's why I had to ask you, like, who are your friends? So your friends, guys.
Oh my God, friends, where are you?
Since you're Togolese and American and UK friends,
okay, whatever, I don't think... whatever, Danny.
Okay, so let's try this. If you're actually just joining us, this is Crude, and today we have Ndey Fatou, Ceesay, a creator, joining us right now on the How Gambian Are You segment. Don't falter. I feel like we have some good Samaritans that will come to your aid in no time. What's your music genre? What kind of music do you listen to?
Everything. I'm into all kinds of music. I love like anything with a good beat or a good vocal that makes me wanna move. I'm down for it, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I like everything.
That's interesting. So that means you like Chronix.
Yeah, I love Chronix.
Ooh, I did not know that. I did not know that. Okay, guys.
Yeah, I love Chronix.
Let's do this.
Trust me. Let's do it.
I will drag you.
I'm ready, Danny. I'm ready.
Question number one. Where in Gambia can you find the Senegambian bridge?
The Senegambian what?
Bridge.
Danny, what are you talking about? What Senegambian bridge?
Exactly. Where in Gambia can you find the Senegambia bridge?
In There's Senegambia? A
inaugurated in 2019.
Okay.
It's...
I wasn't here.
Leggy, that made big news. What are you talking about? That made big news. So yes, it's close by Farafanya, but it's at a place called Babatenda.
Babatenda. Wow,
yeah.
I learned something.
Babatenda Yiritenda. That's in Central River Region. You should know
Central
that.
Central River Region. Wow. Yeah. Okay, so, Question number one down, one off.
Yes. Question number two. What is the most common phrase used in Gambia? It's this one. No, this one I'll give you options. This one I'll give you three options.
Okay.
All right. So option number one or option A, driver memafi. That's
okay.
A.
Yeah.
B. Sonanade.
Okay.
That's B. C. No problem.
No problem.
Are you sure? Is that your final answer?
I'm in between no problem and driver may my fee. Why? I think I'm gonna go with no problem.
No problem.
Yes.
Okay, and the second answer is C, no problem.
Yes, I knew it.
Question number three. In Gambia, most of the houses have the same color. Which
same color? What?
The same color. Like most of the houses are painted the same color. What color or which color is it? Do you want me to give you options?
Yes, please.
Okay. So option A is cream.
Okay.
Option B is white. And option C, yellow.
I would go for white. White.
White.
Yes. I've seen a lot of white houses out here. White and cream. We have a yellow house, but we're different. So, so I think I'm going to go for white.
Are you sure?
Yes. Someone's saying cream, though. I'm not sure.
Wait,
I'll say cream.
Cream?
Yeah.
No, listen, sweetheart, you can't be bouncing off answers. You choose either okay, A fine. Or...
Okay,
so white, A is cream. A is cream, B is white.
Okay, B.
So B white.
Yeah.
And your answer is correct.
Woo! Yes! Yeah, good. I love getting things right.
That's because people can easily afford whitewash, you know, those white stones. So usually, because their houses are just, you know, normal apartment house, so they just use that whitewash. And every year after rain, after the rain washes it, they can wash it back up again. Okay. So number four, give me three rare Gambian names you know. Like not Fatou, the hunger your Fatou guys. Fatou then buddy. There's a lot of Fatous, there's a lot of Bintu. Give me three rare Gambian names.
I really like Munas.
Don't do rare.
It's not rare.
Munas.
Fine.
Munas man Munas.
Okay. What about Karamo? I like Karamo. That's rare.
Okay, I'll take that.
Okay. Yeah, okay. You said three?
Yes.
Damn, Danny, these questions are really hard, you know.
Until you're by my wife.
Okay, so the next... I will say... wow. Rare Gambian names. I would say... Soma? Is that rare? No. I only know one Soma. Alright, it's not rare. Rookie Yatu. That's really rare.
Are you sure?
I can give you
a list of Rookie Yatu.
What about
three rare Gambian
Fanafanas. What are the Fanafanas like? Danny, I don't know.
Oh my god. Okay, fine. We'll move forward. That one you don't fold your hand.
So I failed again.
Question number five. Lamin manga, which you know, right?
Yes.
Was the host of which famous TV shows? In the late 90s, early 2000s on GRTS TV. I'll give you options because that one I know. Your brain is already doing things. Option A.
I'm glad you can see the shock.
Yes. Option A, News at 8. Option B, Children's Magazine. And option C, Extra Touch.
You know what? I'm going to go for Extra Touch. Sounds like a Lemon Manga type of thing. Yeah. It's Extra Touch.
Okay. All right. And is that your final answer?
Final answer, Extra Touch, Lemon Manga, big bro.
And your answer is correct.
Yay!
Okay. Quick one. Number six. Why are handshakes so important in Gambia?
As a sign of respect.
Is that your final answer?
Nobody's giving me any answers. I was just checking. Yeah, that's my final answer.
So a handshake is important, Gambia, as a sign of respect. Is that your final answer?
That's my final answer.
Okay. And your answer is correct.
Yes! Boom! That's 3 out of 4, right? That's 90%.
We got two more. We got two more to go. Two more questions. Okay. The region of Basse, that is Upper River region. Basse. Yeah. What is Basse known for?
Being hot. Being hot. Very hot.
Is that your final answer?
Yes. Basse is hot.
And your answer is correct.
Yes! I know, because I came out of Basse and I was like dark blue one time.
All right, final question. Can you sing the national anthem?
I know, like, maybe the first.
Oh my God. Listen, you have no choice whatsoever right now. You will have to sing the national anthem. That's the final one now. Guys, please, if you're on TikTok, this is where you get content from.
Okay, you know what? I'm going to try my best. I don't know all the words, but okay. I know, you know, mm-hmm. It goes like, din, 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 for the Gambia, our homeland, we strive and walk and pray. Mm-hmm. Something I know is pathetic, but I don't know all the words, but I know the way it sounds like, who the Gambia ever true.
Oh!
Hey, I tried my best, Danny. I gave you the beat. At least I know the beat.
Oh my God! Oh, I can't breathe. You just remixed the entire national anthem. You are a legend. Let me call you a goat. Somebody say encore.
Oh my God. Everybody.
But you did well. And I am fascinated. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much, though. And that was How Gambian Are You? Look at this woman. You did
fail.
Well.
Epic fail.
You did well. Let's participate. You did well. Hey. Just that's for you. I'm throwing a little music up. Hey. Okay. So how would you rate yourself over 10?
Sorry?
How would you rate yourself? How would you give yourself over 10?
How did I do with How Gambian Are You?
Yeah, so over 10, how much would you give yourself?
Probably a 4. I think a four is pretty, like, safe and not, I definitely tried my best, so I'll say a 4. That's effort.
Okay.
Now, I didn't pass, but I didn't totally fail.
Yeah. Now, going back into our conversation, you're very vocal about how you feel and things that matter to you. Currently, there is the hashtag 16 days activism that's currently going on in honor of, you know, creating awareness, extra awareness to gender-based violence and issue regarding basically that women are facing in the society. And as a woman, which of this mini crisis that I can call it, do you feel that you need to lend your voice to, especially at this time?
I think for me, what really hits me the most is domestic violence on women, like all over the world. You know, in some places it's worse than others, but I do feel like, you know, women have been going through this for so long. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, a woman gives birth to a bunch of people and then you wake up in the morning and you're like, oh, let's just burn them all to death. You know, I don't really get it, but I do feel like women are, you know, giving their voice out more, being more vocal about the way they feel, being more powerful, really. You know, you have to carry the energy of, you know what, I am a woman, but I do know my worth and I know who I am. And you're not going to step all over me just because you're a different sex to me. So, yeah, that's the one thing. Like, I just don't think it's cool. I don't think it's right. And, you know, I just feel like women themselves, all of us, we need to be more supportive of each other. That way we can actually stand up for each other. Because, you know, like, divide and conquer, which is what they've been doing. What, I don't know who they is, sorry. But which is what has been happening globally for so long. So, I just think that if we all come together and men also support us and we can literally just be better in our own strength, in our own selves, and hopefully, you know, in like maybe 10 years, things are going to get better or maybe even more. But hey, we have to keep trying and every day is a trying day. So, you know,
I saw a video on Instagram today. A lady posted it where Taraji P. Henson was talking about the power that women hold. It's important that if only women could understand that strength of coming together and working together, the world would certainly be a better place. And until women understand that we as a people are going nowhere, because the crisis in which we currently live in has been created by men over the centuries. And if only women could say, look, let's come together. Let's ignore this voice. Because at the end of the day, regardless of how old, no matter how old we men are, we're still boys. And we'll always be boys. And women have the maturity, they have the understanding, they have the capability to just put two and two together and just allow the world to be a better place. And if they stop tearing each other down, there certainly will be change. And I listened to that. I was like, man, I wish women knew that. I really wish women knew that. Now,
yeah, I totally agree with that.
You spoke about your worth and, you know, finding yourself and all of that stuff. Now you like this now. Your worth now. Is it that you're too good enough for a man? What's going on? I'm trying.
What are you trying to ask, Danny?
I'm trying to.
What are you trying to ask, though?
Are you too good enough for a man? What's going on?
No. That's not the case. I knew you were gonna put me in this corner, but I'm ready for you, so it don't matter. Yeah, it's not the case. You know, like it's not like I'm against love or anything like that. Definitely not. And not touching my hair, which means I'm nervous. But hey, whatever. But like, no. You know, it's not. It's just, I'm I'm at an age that I know what I want.
Mm-hmm.
I know who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm also an intense human being. And not everybody can really be around that intensity all the time.
True.
And I don't see my intensity as a bad thing. I see it as a good thing. So, you know, like, I'm not willing to compromise on it. I'm not going to compromise on it. Yeah.
So no one has caught your eye so far. Like, there's nobody that has caught your eye.
No, people be catching my eye all the time. You know, like, it's not about people not catching my eye. It's just that, you know, like, just because people catch your eye doesn't mean that they're necessarily good for you or they can actually give you what you need. So,
what is that you need? What is that you need?
Oh, my days. Danny. Okay, fine. Well, apart from a kind-hearted human being that allows me to be my full ultimate self, that shows me love and respect and, you know, just be my partner in crime, in good, and all of that, and, you know, be able to just flow with me. I'm not really looking for anything in particular like that. No, like, I don't have like a type or a checklist, but those things really have to be, you know, on the table. I want to feel good around that person. I want to feel like, yeah, this person's on me, this person likes me, you know, this person is checking me out, you know. And that's because that's how I am. When I'm in, so that's kind of just, I think I deserve the same amount of, like, inness.
So, are you particular about race as well?
No, I'm not particular on race. I'm not particular on religion. I'm not particular on any of those things, really. I think that human beings are human beings, and who you are in your heart of hearts is really what the other person would eventually fall in love with, you know. So I'm not for this or for that. I just want somebody that is cool and we can be cool together.
I almost shot my shorts now.
You almost shot your shot?
Yes.
So now that you're far away, married, doing something. Now's when you're telling me you should
like back in the days, you know. But after, like, I was like, no, you know, like, yeah, I'm a small boy. Let me respect myself, you know. So, you know, like,
okay. In fact, you should let me know why didn't you shoot your shoot? Because maybe then I'll be able to know what it is that I'm doing wrong, or if I'm doing anything wrong.
No, why? Look.
Let me switch it back on you.
It's not. What it is like that. It's just the African man has this complexity with strong women, you understand? And it's hard for men to just face up a strong woman. It's like, yo, you know, this is what it is, or this is what I want, or, and I think I like you in that way. Do you understand? But regardless of whatever it is, you're an amazing person, and someone needs to match up that energy. And if you're not able to do that, then trust me, you're falling in a ditch. And you just take your L and walk away. And I think just as the way you are, you don't do it out of purpose, but you just, you know, if you're not feeling that, you know, you're just not feeling it. And you don't really necessarily have to tell the individual, so yeah, you know, I don't see you that way. So
it's on my face, it's in my aura.
Yeah.
Oh no. That's good to know. I'm glad, thank you for being honest. I don't mean to be like that, you know, like, I'm, you know, I have strong brothers that push me around and I have to push them back, and, you know, I got used to just being like, you know what, I'm not gonna deal with this, and I'm not gonna, yeah.
It is what it is. Just quickly, you have studied politics, and you see what's going on in the country. How does that make you feel as a Gambian?
I I don't know whether I should go into this, but I will.
Just your 2 cents. That's it.
Okay, I'm just gonna keep it real. Honestly, I think what's going on in the country is appalling on many levels. You know, like, we went through a stint of really bad times for like 22 years of dictatorship and God knows what. And we were so excited, but thinking that something new was gonna happen. I don't know what's been going on for 4 years, I'm not gonna lie. But I don't think it's necessarily like what I would have thought or what I would have wished for Gambia. So I know 4 years is a little bit amount of time to do much, but I think something should have been done. True. And right now it kind of feels like it's just, we're exactly where we were or worse. That's True. The truth. Like, I'm shocked that there hasn't been a power cut during our conversation, because that is a normality, always been a normality here. Like, when are we finally gonna have stable power? When are we gonna have all these things? Like, other African countries around us are having the bare minimum, and we're just still out here like, oh, there's no water, you know? So, you know, something has got to change, and Gambia gets a lot of aid, and I just don't know where that aid is going. Like, can we just fix some couple of roads and get the water to work?
Sure.
Yeah.
That's I'm going to take a few questions, because you could choose to just give them the shortest of your answers possible. Most people actually sent in their questions over here. What are your thoughts on where Fashion Week in Gambia is at right now? That's one of the questions.
Sorry, say that again.
What are your thoughts on where the level at which Fashion Weekend is at right now?
Well, I think Fashion Weekend is doing great. You know, they're trying their best. They're putting the designers out there. You know, like, the designers also have to, you know, bring something to the table, and Fashion Weekend has to bring something else to the table, and together they can rise. But I think that it's definitely the one thing that we have here right now to showcase, like, you know, art and design in that way. And, you know, like, I'm a bit biased because those are my girls, so I'm not going to sit here and this Fashion Weekend. So, I think that there's always room for work, always, like, with everything.
Okay. A quick one. How does she, there's a question called, does she take interns or mentees? Let me just throw it right there. So does she take interns or mentees?
In terms of mentees, well, right now I'm actually doing a teaching course with SIG.
Yes.
So I'm actually mentoring those girls for a bit. I'm not taking interns yet, but I will be in the future, definitely. And thank you so much for even being interested. You know, that's really, really sweet.
I like that. Okay. Another question. Oh my God. Okay. This part of it. So I certainly will have to try to be very sensitive. All these people are. You have people that are literally crushing on you now. They're asking now, whether you want to drop your number. Who drops their number?
Sorry.
Someone is asking whether you can drop your number so that they
drop my number.
Yes.
When we on, buddy. When they move your number. That's all I can say.
But I drop.
Thank you for the interest, but no.
You wouldn't drop your number. So this is tell us about how you inspire Gambian creative. Love the way you paid for.
Hey, that's my girl. Hey, yeah. Okay, yeah. Well, I like to inspire by doing what I do best.
Okay.
By building stuff, by coming up with concepts, by, you know, being innovative, crafty, thinking outside the box. You know, I just want, if anyone's out there a little bit scared to maybe try something out, I hope that inspires them to try something out, you know, because, yep. Like, you know, I definitely got inspired by seeing my big brother try a lot of stuff, you know, and that's why I'm trying to do that for other creatives that might be more into the fashion side of stuff. Yeah.
Beautiful. What do you do for fun? That's another question.
I love outdoorsy stuff. I love going like kayaking. I went kayaking for the first time in Gambia. When I came this year, it was amazing. The mangroves. I like things like camping. I like going to the beach. I just like being like with the elements of this earth. I think that it really makes you different. Mm-hmm. I like being barefoot. I love being barefoot. I like to dance. I love to dance. Like when I'm dancing, I'm literally in another like realm. Dance is great for me. I like chilling with friends. I like, you know, like I'm pretty into new stuff that I can try out, adventurous stuff, you know. Yeah.
So, okay. One question from me and one question from somebody else. What's your work playlist? Your top five. Your work playlist. Your top five. I mean your
my work playlist.
Yes, top five.
Okay. Top five. Biggie Smalls. Juicy. Okay. Number one. I'm a big Biggie fan. Biggie all the way. Yeah. Hit the Ceiling. Not even sure who that's by, but I just love that song. It's like I'ma hit the ceiling. I love that song. Yeah. And then what else? I'd say Wizkid Ginger.
Ooh.
Okay. Love Wizkid Ginger. So dope. 23 by Burna Boy.
Okay.
Love that song. I have one more to go.
Yes.
One more to go. I would say yes, Lighter by Tyrus Riley.
Ooh. Okay. So final question. As creative director of NFC, like you said, you're just free flowing. You currently have so much going on. What do you think is your purpose?
My purpose?
Yes, what's your purpose?
I would say my purpose is to try inspire, empower, and educate. Like I love to, you know, help people do stuff or try and teach them how to do stuff. I like to motivate people. Like I'm cheerleader of the year. If I believe in you, like I'll motivate you to the end. And empower. Like, you know, women need to stop hiding behind whatever it is they're hiding behind and just step out and just be like, hey, you know what? I'm out here with my sisters and we're gonna have a rocking time. We're gonna do some amazing things, and whether you like it or not, we're gonna do it.
Beautiful. I want to say thank you so much for the time. It's been intriguing getting to understand. It's been a minute since we had a fast conversation.
You know, I miss you, Danny, honestly.
I'm glad that we could do this. I'm glad that we could pretty much just enter your world, kind of just get to understand you a little bit more in the craziness of 2020. Guys, underneath over there, you can follow her on Instagram or pretty much just go to her personal page, Ceesay, or just on Instagram as well. Check out her work. If you have any personal questions, you can DM her as well. Don't ask for her number because it's not going to work. She's going to throw you that face in the DM. That face. Yeah. That face right there in the DM. Thank you so much for being you. And you choose the song that you want us to sign out with. You said Ginger Me, right? You said
Ginger.
So I'm going to ask my co-presenter. That's Alexa. Alexa, play Ginger by Wizkid.
Ginger, featuring Burna Boy by Wizkid from Spotify.
So this is my.
Hey,
and that's how we sign out. That's how we sign out. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for watching, guys. Thank you so much. I saw all the lovely comments. Thank you. Love you guys. Love you all. Thank you.
Bye-bye.